Hello everyone and welcome back to Progressive Learners. Today we continue with the science series. In the science series we had started with food. In food I had explained that we have to move on with the components of food. So in the components of food we have completed with carbohydrates and today we shall begin with proteins. So basically in today's lecture we'll be talking about what are proteins. How are they divided, basically what is their chemical structure and so on. So when you talk about proteins, you should be known that they are made up of certain elements, okay? So now what are those elements that they are made of? So proteins are made of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen. So we see there is a novel element over here, that is nitrogen, which is included in proteins. We saw that carbohydrates were made only up of carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, and that is why they were known as hydrates of carbon, that is carbohydrates. Now we'll be looking at what are these proteins and apart from this what all they may contain. So there are certain additional things that they can be made up of, okay? So they can also have sulfur, okay? They can also have sulfur within them. They can have phosphorus within them. They can have iron, means we'll be talking about conjugated proteins in detail if we are going for that then, okay? If you have to study from your CT point of view, this is more than enough. Now, you should also be knowing the general formula for proteins. Now, the general formula for proteins is going to be given by a structure that is a peptide bond. Now, what is a peptide bond? For that, I'll be explaining the structure basically over here. You have amine group plus you have the carboxyl, your group. Okay. Now what I have drawn over here is a structure which is known as a peptide bond. We'll be studying more in detail about this peptide bond. Basically, this is the positive end, this is the negative end. You need to understand this structure basically and what it is comprised of. So this bond that is formed over here, so I'll just highlight it. Okay, this bond that is formed over here is called as the peptide bond. Now what peptide bond has to do with proteins? So let's look into that. This first structure that you see, I'll be drawing it in a bubble. This is called as an amino acid or an amino acid. And the second structure in the second bubble over here, this is the second amino acid. There can be multiple linkages on this side because I have shown it as negative, okay? There can be multiple linkages of amino acids on this side. Now, what are amino acids, children? Amino acids are the building blocks of proteins. Okay, now why these are known as an amino acid? See, there are two words, amino acid. So from this two word, I'll give you two elements, amino group. That is the NH3 group. When you talk about acid, this is nothing but the COOH group. Okay. So this is a compound which is going to contain an amino group as well as a acid, that is a carboxyl acid group, which is connected to a carbon core, that is a tertiary carbon over here. Now, why do you call this as a tertiary carbon? It is just because it has four valencies that are attached to itself. Now, this is known as a variable R group. Now, what is this variable R group? See, you can see it. I have drawn it here. I have written it here. This I'm R1. This can be R2. Now, if you look at this, children, R is the only arm which is different in each amino acid. Now, when I say each amino acid, so total there are, okay, total there are 20 amino acids in nature. Now, when I say that there are 20 amino acids in nature, it means that we have 20 amino acids which can be available for our use. Out of these 20 amino acids, all the amino acids are going to have the general formula. As NH3CH R group, this is a variable R group, and C double H. Okay, so this is going to be the basic formula, or this is going to be the general formula. Only the R is going to change. This is plus, this is minus. Now, if you see plus minus sign, you understand that if one compound or one structure is having both positive as well as negative, that is anionic and cationic properties, we call it as a zwitterion. So you can also be careful over here that amino acids also are zwitterions because they exhibit both anionic as well as cationic properties. Now, out of these 20 amino acids, children, you have some amino acids which are called as essential amino acids, whereas some of them are called as non-essential amino acids. Now, what are these essential amino acids and what are these non-essential amino acids? Okay, so in these essential amino acids, you include those amino acids which cannot be synthesized by our body. So those amino acids which cannot be synthesized by our body are called as essential amino acid. Means they should be taken in your diet. So available or should be available. Okay. And what do you mean by non-essential amino acids? Non-essential amino acids are those amino acids which can be synthesized. Synthesized by our body. Now, when I say synthesized by our body, so you may say that what is this and why are we synthesizing things in our body? So yes, our body can make a few compounds in our according to its requirement, according to its need. So essential ones are those which our body cannot make and we require them from our dietary sources. Whereas the non-essential ones are those which can be synthesized by our body. Okay, we'll be looking more into detail for this essential and non-essential amino acids. But for now, just one thing that so that we are clear about our concepts. Proteins are nothing but linkages of amino acids which are linked together by peptide bonds. Okay, many such amino acids when linked together, they are going to give you a peptide chain. Okay, they will be giving you a peptide chain and this peptide chain will now fold on each other to give you a protein. So we'll be talking in detail about this also, this structural part also. But just to give you a brief idea that what are we talking about basically. So proteins are made up of amino acids because amino acids are nothing but the building blocks of proteins. As we have seen in carbohydrates, monomers or saccharides, okay, were the building blocks of those carbohydrates. Now, these amino acids have one amino end and one carboxyl end. The general formula is given in this manner. we see that they exhibit both cationic as well as anionic property. Now, there are total 20 amino acids in nature, out of which some are essential and some are non-essential. Now, how many are these essential amino acids and how many are the non-essential amino acids? Well, there are certain texts which give varied opinions on this. If I have to write it in my form, I write it as 8 plus 2. I'll be explaining why I've written it as plus 2 and not 10. And non-essential, I'll be clubbing them as 10 because I have written plus 2 over here. Otherwise, they can be as 12. Now, so let's look into details. Now, we had started with first, that is essential amino acids. We have two types, essential and non-essential amino acids. And I had given this bifurcation as 8 plus 2. I'll be telling you why this is 8 plus 2. This 2 stands for the semi-essential amino acids. Now, why they are semi-essential amino acids? Why are they called as semi-essential? Just because, just because they are essential. In infants. Okay, so in the early childhood stage, you require these two amino acids, and in the adulthood, you can synthesize, the body can synthesize them on their own. So let's look at the list of the essential amino acids. The first one, phenylalanine. The second one, valine. The third one, tryptophan. Fourth, methionine. Fifth, threonine. Sixth, isoleucine. Seventh, histidine. Eighth, arginine. Ninth one is lysine and 10th one is going to be leucine. So these are your 10 essential amino acids. Out of these, number 7 and number 8, that is histidine and arginine, are semi-essential. Okay, so means they are going to remain essential only in the early stages of life. Now, why are they essential during early stages of life? What is the important function? So let's look at the functions of these two. Basically, histidine produces or helps to produce hemoglobin. So it's a carrier molecule. This hemoglobin is a carrier protein for oxygen. You all know that. Okay. So it's very important to produce hemoglobin. Next, it ensures the regulation of growth. So the growth patterns are regulated via histidine. These are some of the important functions. There are some more functions also. Arginine. What does arginine do? Arginine has an important role in cell division. Now, cell division is very important during the growth stage of life. Okay. Because there you have rapid cell division, which is happening place. You also get help in the healing of wounds. It is also helpful, that is arginine also improves your immune function, which is very critical, okay, during the early stages of life, because we know that small children are prone to various illnesses, okay. So these were your essential amino acids. Now let's look at the non-essential ones. So we have B, non-essential amino acids. Now, which are these non-essential amino acids, or how many are these? 10. Okay. Now, 10 in whom? In infants, and 12 in adults. Because we know that we have a total of 20. So this 8 plus 2, 10 over here, and this 10 over here. So infants have their 20. And this 8 is going to be in only adults. So these 8 plus these 12 will give you 20 there. Okay. So let's look at these non-essential amino acids. Okay. The 10 essential, because I have already included these semi-essential 2 over here. So I'll be writing the remaining leftover 10 non-essential ones down. So the first one, glycine. Second, alanine. Third, aspartate. Fourth, serine. Fifth, cysteine. Sixth, proline. Seventh, aspergine. Eighth one is glutamine. Then you have tyrosine. And the 10th one that makes to the list is glutamate. Okay, so these are your 10 essential non-essential amino acids. Now, one thing that you need to look out for in the essential and non-essential list category is these two. First, you can see this is methionine, okay? And here you have cysteine. Okay, methionine and cysteine both are sulfur containing. Okay, both are sulfur containing. So if you have any disulfide bonds or you have proteins which contain sulfur in them, so you need to understand that they are typically going to have methionine as well as cysteine as their component amino acids. So I hope the essential and the non-essential amino acids are clear to you. Okay, so the energy yield, okay, energy obtained from 1 gram of protein is going to be approximately 5.65, okay, kilocalories, which we sum up to, or approximately we write it down as 4 kilocalories. So in places you may get it as 5 kilocalories, or they may give you a round figure of approximately 4 kilocalories. Now, what is the requirement or the dietary requirement in adults? Okay, so the requirement, okay, daily requirement. In adults is going to be 50 to 60 grams, okay? Whereas in children, this was in adults, in children, it is going to be more, okay? So it will be more than 50 to 60 grams. It depends upon the age group in which they fall. Let's continue. The next is types of proteins. In types of proteins, you'll be seeing various types. In that, the first category of it is A, that is simple proteins. This is based on the composition of the proteins, okay, this bifurcation, and conjugated proteins. Now, what are simple proteins and what are conjugated proteins? Simple proteins are only composed of amino acids, okay? So if you have only amino, purely amino acids, then you call it as simple proteins. Whereas what are conjugated proteins? You have amino acids, which will form the protein part, plus you have the other groups, or which will form the non-protein part. Okay, so in this manner, you have conjugated proteins, you have simple proteins. Now, if I have to give you examples over here, so example for simple proteins will be albumin, globulin. Globulin are your circular proteins, okay? These are the two examples there. I can give you your nucleoproteins. Nucleoproteins, very easy to understand. Let's break them up. Nucleo stands for nucleic acid. Whereas proteins, you all know, proteins stand for proteins. I have one more example. So nucleoproteins, you have nucleic acid, nucleo stands for nucleic acid, and then you have the proteins. One more example that I can give you is of phosphoproteins, or to make it more simple, I'll write lipoproteins. This is easy to understand. Okay, in lipoproteins, now see which are the two parts. You have lipids or fats. Okay, and then you have proteins. So this is how we have two types of proteins. There are other types of proteins also. Let's talk about them also. B, you can also categorize proteins as monomeric proteins. This is A, monomeric proteins, and B, multimeric proteins. Now, what do you mean by this monomeric, multimeric? Okay, we'll break up the word so that we understand. Meric stand for the chains, and mono stands for one, as we know. Multi stands for many, meric stands for chains again. So, if the proteins are made up of one, or I'll write it down, made up of one polypeptide chain. Now, what is a polypeptide chain? I had earlier explained about the peptide linkage. You remember in the previous few minutes, we have completed with the peptide chain. Now, polypeptide chain means when we have many peptide linkages, that is called as a polypeptide chain. So, if it is made up of only one polypeptide chain, then that protein is called as a monomeric protein. Now, what are the examples over here? So, I'll just give you the examples also so that it's very clear to you. You have lysosome or lysozyme, sorry. Lysozyme, myoglobin, the carrier of oxygen in your muscles. Okay, myoglobin. Then, what are multimeric proteins? Obviously, here you have made up of many polypeptide chains. Okay, I'll give you the examples over here. Insulin. Yes, your hormone children, insulin. Yeah, hemoglobin. All these are multimeric proteins, means they are made up of many polypeptide chains. Okay, so we also have first class proteins and second class proteins. Now, first class proteins are those proteins which have all the amino acids, and second class proteins are those which have incomplete amount of amino acids. So, what are complete proteins? We generally say that proteins derived from animal sources are called as complete. So, I'll just make a note over here. Okay, we have one more type, that is, we can also say that there are other two types of proteins which are complete proteins and incomplete proteins. So here you get all the 20 amino acids, and generally they are from an animal source, and this incomplete ones are generally from a plant source. They fall short of those 20 amino acids that we just now studied. Now, we'll be talking about the structure. Okay, so let's move on. Proteins are going to have certain levels of structure. So we'll be talking about proteins on basis of their structure. I'll just give you an overview, because detail is not required for your CTET exam. We don't ask it in the school level. It is required for your TGT and PGT exams. So it won't be asked for your CTT. So first one, primary protein or the primary structure. Second one is the secondary structure. Third one is called as a tertiary structure. And the last one is called as a quaternary structure. Okay, now what are this primary structure and all? Primary structure is only going to be a polypeptide chain. What is secondary structure? The polypeptide chain gets folded on each other to give you sheets and helixes. Okay, that is secondary structure. Now what is tertiary structure? Tertiary structure is going to be when you have particular active sites that are getting formed, okay, on the ends, on the proteins, okay, and active sites, as we know, are included in enzymes. And what about quaternary structure? These are the functional proteins, okay. So I'll give you some examples over here so that it's easy for you to understand. Not required, but still, here you can give an example of hemoglobin. Here all enzymes basically are tertiary proteins. In secondary structure, you can have keratin. Keratin protein, which is found in your hair and in your nails. You can have silk fiber. Okay, and what about primary? Okay, insulin. Insulin is an example of primary structure protein. So this was about your important facts about proteins. Okay, now we'll see that what are the sources of proteins. Okay, very important. Children generally tend to ask the sources. So sources of protein. Animal sources are on a large amount over here, so I can give you many animal sources first. Milk, yeah. Then you have meat, fish, eggs, okay. Then you have pulses, you have all the dals, okay. All these are going to be good sources of proteins. Now, hemoglobin, then visual pigment, cytochromes, all these are proteins, and we find them, or the pigments, okay, we are basically talking about pigments, and these pigments are found in your plant sources. Now, what do you know about the deficiency, okay? Because many a times we have these questions which arise. Deficiency of proteins. You have two names which you need to remember over here. A. Kashwarkar. Now what is Kashwarkar? Kashwarkar is nothing but a deficiency of protein in children. Children over here are going to have, you know, symptoms. Now these symptoms are going to be stunted growth. They are faces, you know, swollen faces they have. Then the limbs are, you know, swollen. Then they have some skin diseases. They have diarrhea. The hair is discolored. So all these are, you know, symptoms of Kwashiorkor. And Kwashiorkor is only a deficiency of protein. The second one which we talk about comes under a PEM deficiency, which is marasmus. Now, marasmus is actually a protein energy malnutrition. Now, what do you mean by a protein energy malnutrition? It is deficiency of proteins plus carbs in children. Okay, so this is just seen in malnourished children, so children who, areas where you know you do not have enough amount of food. Okay, so children become very lean, children become thin, and you know they tend to have their growth, normal growth rate, which is you know stopped, and you can see yeah they are stunted. Okay, so there are two important things that you should remember. Children get confused over here. Kashwarkar is only the deficiency of protein, whereas marasmus falls under PEM, that is protein energy malnutrition. And when we say malnutrition, you should understand it is due to lack of food. So poverty stricken areas generally have children who have marasmus. Okay, now one last thing that is left for proteins is just the test for proteins. So what are the tests for proteins basically? When you talk about proteins, children, okay, and if you want to test if this given food material contains protein or no, what you do is you take the food and get it converted into a paste or powder form. So if it is a little bit sticky, it will be a paste, it will be a powder. If it's a powder, you add 10 drops of water. So we have 10 drops of H2O there. Okay. Now, in this solution, that is this powder, this paste, okay, in this total solution, you are going to add two things. Okay. Now, what would be those two things? Plus, you add 2 drops of CuSO4, that is copper sulfate, and 12 drops of caustic soda, that is sodium hydroxide. Okay. Once you add this, okay, the entire color of this mixture is going to change. If the color turns violet, then you say that, therefore, food contains protein. Okay, so done. You have the test for proteins. So this was all about proteins. If you all need to know anything about the lecture, please leave them in the comment box. If you have any doubts regarding this lecture, please leave them in the box suggestions. Okay, and if you have liked the lecture, please hit the like and the subscribe button. Thank you and have a nice day.